It is storm season. I talked about it at the beginning of this. We're going to take you through some things that I think are misunderstood, especially this one right now. But again, severe weather awareness week is this week. It's a great week to talk to your family and listen. Some of the stuff we say is like, you know, overbearing, but you need to know all of these things. You need to know this one. You got to know where your shelter is, and that's actually important for me and my house. Ours is under all the way to the basement, under the staircase. We have a little door where we go under the staircase. You just got to know where it is, and we'll explain that here in a little bit. But this is the number one thing that I think the public struggles with, and I get why, so we're going to explain it. It's the wall cloud versus shelf cloud debate, because most of the time, what does this look like here? Well, it looks like a wall, so people call it a wall cloud, which I wish they changed the actual words, but this is what it is. So you're not wrong with your brain thinking, but let's explain it. Okay, shelf cloud. This is the one where it looks like a wall, literally, but it's coming through. What does this indicate? So when I'm looking at this type of setup, what am I looking at? Well, this spans the horizon of a leading edge of a thunderstorm, typically a squall line. Okay, so this is going to be a downburst, a microburst, or very strong winds on the leading edge. This is typically what comes with a gust front. A lot of words for it, whatever you call it, it's fine. But this is not a tornado wall cloud. This is not a tornado cloud, okay? Not a tornado cloud. This is a tornado cloud. So when you hear the term wall cloud, but it is an actual shelf cloud, just let your neighbor know, nope, that's not a tornado. What am I looking for when I'm looking for a tornado? So look at the structure of this. You see how there's actually like sunshine around this thing? You see that? Well, that's because this is a supercell thunderstorm. It's one isolated cell. This is a squall line. Different. You'll see when I'm watching a thunderstorm develop, even in the supercell, there's a little bit of rotation. But you're looking for a lowering base. And actually, the tornado, you wouldn't see it behind the trees. It would be a small little tornado and it'd go right there. So this is a lowering base of clouds, and it's rotating. You'll see this thing rotating. And if you see the cloud dropping and rotating, that's the wall cloud. That's the beginning stages of a tornado. This one is a much more dangerous situation than the shelf cloud. But which one impacts us here most in Minnesota? That one. 99 out of 100 times it's a shelf cloud. That's why when you're dealing with that, it's less people, but the impacts are great, right? Because we're talking about large tornadoes. If I see something like that, I'm worried about a large damaging tornado. So let's talk about that tornado safety. Again, most important thing we talked about earlier, if there's anything you take from any of the severe weather safety stuff, it's just know your tornado safety. Go to a basement or the smallest center room. Anything without a window, of course. Stay away from windows. So you're going to want to get into a bathroom. Let's say I lived in Springfield, Missouri. And there's way more tornadoes in Springfield, Missouri than here. And we did not have a basement. And I hated that, but it was what it was. There are no basements there. So we would go into a bathroom in the center of our home, and we'd just cover our heads in the actual shower. We would get beneath that, the top of the shower head. So again, stay away from windows and then cover yourself if you can. I also had a large, this was a little more extreme because I didn't have a basement, but I had a... So over the bed, you could put like not a 2x4, but you could put plywood over yourself. If you really had to, you could slide that on top of you and get under the actual, bath. And that is going to give you more protection as well. So cover yourself in any way, but that's what I did. And I know that was a little bit more of an extreme case, but I live really close to Joplin, Missouri, and I was a young meteorologist and I saw what happened in Joplin. So I wanted to be prepared. So if you're going to be in a more of an apartment setup, I would find the stairwell, because the stairwells rarely get blown out because it's solid cement. Find an area of solid cement. I would go into the stairwell all the way to the bottom and then go underneath the stairwell if I was in a condo or condominium or some type of apartment. You don't want to stay in your apartment, get to that stairwell, and then get to the bottom level. That's obviously a good idea there. And these are things that you don't really think about most of the time, but when you're in that situation, you need to know where to go. Again, so Again, tornado safety. We continue this another look at this here. We were talking about this, but in great detail. You can see typically a deck, kitchen, bathroom, bedroom. You see all these in this situation, you really don't have much away from windows, except where would you go? Well, you could look at this closet would be a good option, assuming this bathroom has a window, because obviously things can blow through the window. So again, I would go in this setup, I would go into your closet from the hallway, or I like the bathroom idea, but I'm not a huge fan of the bathroom if it has windows. So again, that depends. Of course, basement is gonna be number one, but we had talked about that in great detail that not everybody has the options of a basement, and that's okay. Covering yourself is the number one thing you need to actually do. So we all know the basement is the best thing. Let's talk about how tornadoes form. So what is wind shear? You know what wind shear is? We talk about shear all the time. That is winds changing direction as you go up the column of air. There are winds from the surface all the way up thousands and thousands of feet high up to the jet stream. So the perfect wind direction at the surface is a southeast wind rotating to the southwest just above the surface. That is the most dangerous wind shear. And we have things in meteorology that we classify our wind shear as called bulk shear. And we have a value that we place on the bulk shear, which would indicate how much shear we have. So we have actual numbers that we can plug into equations, but that's what wind shear actually is. So what happens when you have wind shear is it gives you a rolling column of air. You kind of imagine this, right? If you put two things like this together, they just start spinning. So you got this rolling column of air, but that's not how tornadoes form. How do you get tornadoes to form? Well, there's one very important thing in tornadoes, and there's one important thing in life if you want to learn weather, and that is warm air rises, right? In everything you do, where's the warmest spot right now in this building? Well, you're not here, but I can tell you it's on the ceiling. Coldest weather is down there. Think about your basement. It's always the coldest spot. Why? Because the warm air is escaping it and going to the north. That's called an updraft. In the actual weather world, an updraft is the most important thing because it can take that column of air and it can launch it higher. And when you interact this updraft with a downdraft, which is the end of a thunderstorm, which to tie this all together, what is a downdraft? Well, we talked about in a shelf cloud, for example, there's a downdraft. It's that cold air which wants to sink. So if cold air wants to sink and warm air wants to rise, the more extreme you have the instability, the faster those two go. So you have really strong updraft, which means really strong downdraft. And remember, we have that column of rotating air. So if you have all four of those things together, you take that column of air, you lift it north with the updraft, it's spinning, and you rush it down with the downdraft. That is how you get a tornado. It is one of the hardest things to form. We see a lot of them. In fact, I don't know the exact stat, but I know it's around. I'll just say this quick, and you can make a guess. How many do you think of the world's tornadoes are? Think of the whole world are here in the United States. How many do you think? I would say 5% or something, 10%. 70, I don't know the exact stat, we'll have to look it up, but it's around 75%. 75% of the world's tornadoes happen in the U.S. Why? Because we have the dream set up for this. We have super extreme weather in the United States. We have a desert in areas in Oklahoma, literally. Western Oklahoma, desert. Highest moisture ever coming from the Gulf of Mexico, and we're far enough north to have the jet stream. Those three things coming together creates wild, wild weather. So again, I think that's pretty cool. I hope you guys learned something here. Maybe we'll do this again tomorrow. If you guys ever want to ask me a question, you can go to my meteorologist, John Ziegler, Facebook page. I love answering questions on there. Plus, I try to post some of this nerdy stuff as well. That is how a tornado forms and some tornado safety. Thank you for joining us here on KARE 11+. You have a great day.